Hey everybody, I'm excited to say that right over my shoulder is the DIY NAS 2023 edition. This year's DIY NAS build features the JONSBO N1 case, an Intel Celeron N5105 CPU, 32 GB of DDR4 RAM, four 2.5 GB network interfaces, and TrueNAS scale mirrored on a pair of NVMe SSDs. And best of all, I managed to do this for just under $630. I've been building DIY NAS machines now for over 10 years, and I haven't been this excited about the value of a DIY NAS since maybe the first one that I ever built. So let's go ahead and hand this over to Brian from the past, and he can talk about all of the hardware components that went into the DIY NAS 2023 edition. When it comes to choosing a motherboard for my DIY NAS builds, I'm always on the lookout for a motherboard that meets the following criteria. It's small form factor, it's got an integrated CPU, and hopefully that CPU is passively cooled. And lastly, it needs to be able to have support for at least 6 SATA devices. And this year I found this Topton N5105 NAS motherboard on AliExpress. It's tiny at 170 mm by 170 mm. It's got an Intel Celeron N5105 CPU built into the board. It has 6 SATA 3.0 ports. It's got 2 M.2 NVMe PCIe 3 slots. And as an added bonus, it's got these 4 2.5 GB Intel network adapters. I'm really excited about how the Topton N5105 NAS motherboard practically meets all of my perfect criteria. For the system memory, I wound up picking out a 32 GB kit of DDR4 3200 RAM. The RAM itself is non-ECC RAM, which to some might be a bit of a controversial choice. I wrote a blog quite a few years back kind of outlining where I stand on the whole ECC versus non-ECC debate. I'll leave a link to it down in the video description. But if you've had a negative experience with non-ECC RAM in your DIY NAS, I'd love to hear more about it in the comments below. The component that I've been most excited about in this year's DIY NAS build is sitting right behind me on my desk. It's the JONSBO N1 case. The case fits a mini ITX motherboard. It's got a real clever little system for holding up to 5 3.5-inch hard drives. There's an additional mounting point for a 2.5-inch hard drive. And it's got a cool little feature where you can orient it in two different ways. You can either have it vertical like I do using its feet, or you can lay it horizontally on your desk. When it's in its horizontal orientation, it reminds me a lot of the old school CD-ROM or floppy disk holders that we had back when I was a kid. To store the operating system, I want picking up a pair of these PNY 250 GB Gen 3 NVMe SSDs. They are way too big for what I'm actually going to wind up using them for, but around $22, the price was right. Like a lot of the other small form factor cases that I've used over the years in my DIY NAS builds, the JONSBO N1 requires an SFX or SFXL power supply. So I wound up picking out this power supply from SilverStone, and hopefully that'll fit the bill. Because clearance is tight in the JONSBO N1, and because no motherboard ever comes with enough SATA cables, I went ahead and picked up a whole bunch of these right angle SATA cables by Rosewill. The assembly of this year's NAS was really straightforward. The combination of the Topton N5105 NAS motherboard and the JONSBO N1 case made it feel pretty roomy compared to prior year's NAS builds. My biggest complaint about assembling this year's DIY NAS build is the fact that the JONSBO N1 case has front panel connectors for audio and USB 3, but there are no headers on the Topton N5105 motherboard for those. So those cables were just floating loose, and in that tight cramped space, it was hard to cable manage and tuck those loose cables away. I didn't have any kind of issues installing or setting up TrueNAS scale. I loaded this year's DIY NAS build up with 5 of my spare hard drives left over from past upgrades, and I ran some benchmarks over SMB using Crystal Disk Mark. On both sequential reads and writes, I was able to saturate the 2.5 gigabit network connection between my desktop computer and the NAS. I even replicated some of my media library from my primary NAS to this year's NAS and installed the Jellyfin app from the TrueChart catalog, and the NAS did an admirable job of serving up that media. While I was doing these tasks, I was also monitoring the power consumption. Over a 36-hour time span, the average wattage was right at 60, with a peak of 78 watts during the throughput benchmark. Over that 36-hour time span, the NAS used 3.4 kilowatt hours of energy. As I've done in the past, I'm giving away the DIY NAS 2023 edition to one of my followers. I've left a link down in the video description to the blog that I wrote about this same NAS, and in that blog you'll find the details on this contest. Altogether, I'm really pleased with how this year's NAS build turned out. I think it's a fantastic value compared to machines that are $200, $300, even $400 more. But enough about what I think of the DIY NAS 2023 edition. I want to hear from you guys. What do you think worked well? What could have been done better? Have you recently built something similar? Tell me all about it down in the comments below. I appreciate you all for tuning in and learning about the DIY NAS 2023 edition. And I hope you have a great day.